being here. You've heard so much about me, but please discount all that, you know. There was a very famous scene in a movie called The Tramp, which was by Charlie Chaplin. You know what was in the scene? The scene was that there was this Charlie Chaplin who's playing the role of a beggar. And he goes in the morning to a road to beg, and he usually used to go in one particular direction. So he decided, let me go the other direction today. So he went the other direction and he put his carpet down and he sat down over there. And very strangely, after some time, it was early morning, a man passed by him and saluted him. So he was a little shocked. Why are they saluting me? After a few minutes, another person passed by him and he saluted him. He was even more shocked. After that, every single person who was passing him was saluting him. He was totally flabbergasted. Then he thought, might we have done something great? You know, God has blessed me today. That's why I have such a big fan following. Everybody is following, saluting me. Everybody is talking to me that way. Then when it went on and on, and there was an admiral who went by that place, who was an army commander, and when he too saluted him, he could not bear it any longer. Another person passed by and told, why is everybody saluting me? And immediately the reply told, who's saluting you? You're sitting under the statue of Abraham Lincoln. You're saluting him and you're not saluting you. So that is my case. You might have heard a lot about me, but I'm still a beggar in the field of public speaking. I'm still learning a lot, just like y'all. Just like y'all are freshers, even I'm fresher in one way or the other. Okay, let me start off. Did you know that 38% of all tsunami victims do not die due to drowning? Did you know that 17% of all soldiers do not die because of bullet wounds or any fatal injury? Did you know that 55% of all suicide cases are not due to a current real life crisis? Then what causes all these deaths? What causes all these deaths? All these deaths are caused by one of the oldest and strongest emotions which have been experienced by man, which is this four-letter word called fear. Have you heard of the word fear? Now, how do you define this word fear? Fear has been defined by various people. If you look at the Webster's dictionary, fear has been defined as a feeling of agitation or anxiety caused by the presence or imminence of danger. But if I were to tell what is fear, fear can just stand for one thing: fantasized experience appearing real. And today when you are joining this college, you all will have a lot of fear. You all will have a lot of very, very apprehensions. What am I going to do for the next 3 years or 4 years? Do you think I'll be able to adjust? Do you think I'll be, you'll be thinking in your mind, should I be able to make friends with people? Will I do well in my exams? And this fear is the single largest cause for failure. This fear is the single largest cause for all your problems in life. That's why today I decided I'll speak a little bit about fear before I go on to anything else. Because I can understand when Roosevelt, the president of USA, once said, the greatest fear of mankind is the fear of fear itself. When you do anything in life, you get scared. But what is fear? False evidence appearing real. It is nothing. It is a construction of your mind. Whom do you have to fear? What do you have to fear about? Why do you get these jittery feelings? Let me unravel this. You all have heard, who do you think invented the telephone? Alexander Graham Bell, yes? But did you know that there were two scientists who were much before Alexander Graham Bell? You know their names were Elisha Gray and Antonio Meucci. They also had developed the prototype of the telephone much before him. But you know what happened? What happened was, Elisha Gray was very scared that his patent will be rejected and everybody will laugh at him. So he did not register his patent. You know Antonio Meucci? He feared that his prototype won't work once it is registered. He was very scared and he didn't register it. Who registered it? Alexander Graham Bell. And we all remember Alexander Graham Bell. He started the Bell Laboratories. They became a millionaire. Elisha Gray and Antonio Meucci died away into ignominy. Nobody remembered them. What caused the problem? That single emotion called fear. You know, Who invented the aeroplane? The Wright brothers. But did you know there was a scientist who came much before the Wright brothers? His name was Samuel Pierpont Langley. What was his name? Samuel Pierpont Langley. He was such a great inventor that he had developed the complete prototype of the aeroplane with engine. Everything was done. But the problem was that Samuel Pierpont Langley got scared. If I take off with my own invention and I fall down, what will happen? I'll die. And he did not register his patent. He was scared of losing his life and he did not experiment with his own invention after making it. We all know Alexander Graham Bell. We all know the Wright brothers. But nobody of you all know Antonio Meucci, Elisha Gray, Samuel Pierpont Langley, because of this dreaded emotion called fear. Fear can cause you to lose your rationality. It can make you think in absurd ways. You do not know how people will behave when they are scared. Remember when you come out, you are called on stage, your legs start shaking, your face starts becoming red, you become purple all the way, isn't it? You can have amazing sort of reactions because of this fear. Around 2 months back, I was reading the newspaper and there was a very chilling encounter of a person in London. This man in London had gone with his friends to a bar. And once he went there, it was very late in the night, the bar was about to close. They somehow forced the bar owner to open the bar for a few drinks. The bar owner opened it and he told, okay, you all can go get the beer from the cold storage. Now there were four friends, three of them were already a little bit high. They told the fourth friend, get some extra beer from the cold storage. This man went, he went into the cold storage, but he got locked in the cold storage. The other three friends who were high, they forgot about him and left. The bar owner locked the bar and went off. The next day in the morning, they found nail scratch marks on the cold storage door and this man was dead. Now the kicker was not that this man was dead because he froze to death. The kicker was that the bar owner said that he had shut off the electricity of the entire bar. So there was no cold storage which was working at that particular point of time. There was a window in the cold storage which would have let the natural air in. But this man was so scared that he's going to froze to death, that he kept on kicking at the door, he kept on scratching at the door, and he died of a cardiac arrest and not because he froze to death. He was so scared of dying that he died himself. And this happens to most of us. We die each moment. Have you heard of a guy called Tipu Sultan? Remember, Tipu Sultan had once said that it's better to live one day as a lion rather than to live for 1,000 years as a lamb who's scared of dying again and again. We keep keeping this fear in our mind. I will tell you some remedies at a later point of time. But just remember, you keep thinking of fear and you keep that entire emotion in your head. And when that emotion gets into your body, you are never able to perform at your optimum level. And I'm telling you this because it's a personal experience. When I was in the second PUC, we had gone for an adventure camp. I was in a college where we had gone to an adventure camp where we had to stay in tents out in the outskirts of the city. Now what happened was, suddenly at around 2 o'clock in the night, one boy came rushing to us and he told, you know, our Hindi teacher, he had gone out to answer nature's call and a snake has bitten him and he's lying down there. We have to rush and get the ambulance. There was a huge crowd of students around our Hindi teacher and he was lying there. He was completely blue, he was completely purple. We thought he's going to die any moment. And everybody, they had already sent a person to fetch an ambulance from the nearest hospital. In those days, the hospital was very far off, isn't it? We didn't have the Manipal hospital, etc. So it was very far off and they had gone. And we were very scared because this man was almost, he was hardly breathing, our Hindi teacher. Then suddenly some boy asked, where is that snake? And somebody looked at him and see, he's that side. He bit our sir and he's lying on that side. So that student was very angry because this Hindi teacher was his favorite teacher. So he wanted to kick that snake and kill it. So he ran behind that snake and he kicked it and he hit it with a with a stick. Then he shouted, hey, it's not a snake, it's a rope. Now immediately the Hindi teacher heard it and he told it was a rope, but I thought it was a snake, and immediately got up. He was not dying because of the snake bite. What had happened was the rope had got caught in his pant, and there was a small iron nail in that rope which had actually hurt him, and he had thought the snake had. And that imagination of him getting bitten by a snake had caused him so much trauma. Can you believe it? He was almost on the verge of dying because he thought that he was being bitten by a snake, but he actually hadn't been bitten by a snake. Now, what do you do when you are gripped with fear, when you are gripped with the fear of public speaking, you are gripped with the fear of coming on stage, you are gripped with the fear of so many different things, you are scared of doing your homework, whether it will be approved or not, you are scared of meeting people because they might reject you or not. You have so many phobias in your life. Where do you get rid of these phobias? Where is the actual remedy to come out of this entire grasp of fear? Let me tell you some remedies. The first remedy was given to me by my teacher when I was in 8th standard. I was not a very good public speaker. I wasn't even a very, very good person in going on stage, but even then my voice was okay enough. So my teacher in 8th standard, I studied in Bishop Gordon's, was a teacher called Mrs. Ruth Sequeira. She was in my house teacher, and she told me, Rajdeep, why don't you go and speak, you take part in the debate contest. Now can you believe it, debate contest? They used to give the topic one day in advance, 2 days in advance, so that we can prepare. So I still remember the topic, does the Indian police cater to our needs? So the topic was, is the Indian police doing a good job or a bad job? And I was told that the Indian police is doing a great job. I had to speak for the topic, the Indian police does cater to our needs. I was so panicky, can you believe it? The next day, I didn't go to school. I had complete fever, my whole body was burning because I was so scared what will happen on stage, and my feet were cold. My mother called the doctor, and the doctor said, for the first time I am seeing this type of specimen. His body is hot and his feet are completely cold. Oh my God. Whatever little I had to prepare, I prepared that day. The next day, 2 o'clock in the afternoon was the debate. At 9:30 in the morning, I went to my teacher and I told her, ma'am, I can't take part. Ma'am, please, I'm really scared. I do not know what I'm going to do on stage. Thousands of people looking at me. I do not know what I'm going to do. I don't want to take part at all. Please. Mrs. Sequeira was a very cool lady. She told me, come in the break and meet me. Those days we had a tea break at around 10:30 in the morning. So after attending the first 2 hours, I went over there. She took me to her room and she told me, Rajdeep, why do you not want to take part? I told, ma'am, I'm really scared. Please, ma'am, I cannot take part. After that, she gave me a lecture for around 5 to 10 minutes, which completely changed my life. Let me tell you what she told me. She told me, Rajdeep, when you were small, and when you used to fall down, people used to laugh at you. Did you ever bother? When you're a small kid, 3 or 4 years, you're walking around, you're very happy, you're running around, and you trip and you fall. People will laugh, oh, he fell down. Will you get up and start telling, oh my God, what did people think of me? No. You used to laugh yourself, get up, dust yourself, and start walking away. But as you grow up, you start judging yourself by what other people think of you rather than what you think of yourself. Today, at the age of 15, 16, if you fall down, the first thing which you'll do is you'll look around and see whether people have seen you or not. She told me, Rajdeep, every individual is made up of 3 layers. What are those 3 layers? These are the 3 psychological layers which we are made of. The layers are being good, feeling good, and looking good. When we are small, when we are small kids, what do we want to do? We want to be good first. Remember, as a small kid, you will give your pencil box to somebody else, you will give your sweets to somebody, if somebody is hungry, you will help them. You want to be good first. After that, you want to look good. You want to feel good. You want to run around the grass. You want to catch the butterflies. You want to eat ice cream. You want to feel good. And lastly, you want to look good. You're not bothered about what people are thinking of you. But as you keep growing up, the entire thing gets upturned. You want to look good first, you want to feel good second, and you want to be good. Everything in your life starts depending on what other people think of you rather than what you think of yourself. You want to look good. If I come on stage, if I speak, 100 people will start passing judgments of you. If I come and ask my friend out for dinner, what will she think? My God, suppose she takes out a chappal and picks me. Understand? Well, all might have decided already, right? 1 year into the thing. If I answer questions in class, oh, all my friends will think I'm a nerd, so I better not answer the questions. Your entire life becomes depending on what other people are thinking of you, which is extremely dangerous. I have a neighbor. She was only 24 years old when her husband died of a car accident. She comes and she cries in front of my mother, in front of my wife. She keeps telling my wife, oh my God, I don't know what to do. My husband has died. My wife tells her, why don't you get married again? And she says, no, 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 I'm a Tamil Brahmin. What will the entire world think of me that after my husband has died, I'm married again? She's going to ruin the next 50 years of her life because she's going to base her life on what other people are going to think of her. Do you want to feel good, look good, or be good? Mrs. Sequera asked me that question that day. And I was shocked. I did not know what to answer. Then she told me something which again drastically turned me. She told me, Rajdeep, I'm going to give you a two-word mantra today. I told, what, ma'am? Two-word mantra. She told, yes, remember these two words. When you remember these two words, fear will go out of your life. I told, ma'am, what are those two words? She told, Rajdeep, the two words are so what? I told, ma'am, so what? She told, yes, so what? She told, when you laugh, you fear appearing a fool. So what? Fools have a lot of fun. When you cry, you fear appearing sentimental. So what? At least you let out your emotions. When you hope, you fear disappointment. So what? At least you saw the brighter side of life. When you love, you fear rejection. So what? You at least had a blissful feeling. When you try, you fear failure. So what? At least you made an attempt. But the greatest fear of all is the fear to risk nothing, for the man who risks nothing, does nothing, is nothing, and becomes nothing. So just remember the words. So what? It doesn't make a difference. You are not going to live your life based on what other people are going to think of you. Remember that. You have to live your own life. How much ever the other people do, your success is your success, your failure is your failure. If Dhoni hits a 6 and he wins the IPL, he's not going to give you 6 lakhs for hitting that 6. Are you going to get a 6? What do you get? Happiness. You might jump and run over there. But is that success your success? So remember those words. So what? Isn't it the entire history of mankind has been based on people who have told so what to life? Isn't it? The entire history of mankind has been based on those people who have said so what to life. America would never have got freedom from apartheid if Martin Luther King wouldn't have said so what to the white regime. He said, so what? Doesn't matter if they hang me, they kill me, they assassinate me. I will fight for the rights of the black. Rosa Parks was the lady who started the entire civil rights disobedience in the American. You know, she was traveling in a bus and the conductor told her, please get up because a white man has come. She was 55 years old. She said, no, I'm going to sit down. She said, so what? She said, so what if a white person has come? It doesn't make a difference. There were 5 or 6 passengers in that bus who saw this lady's guts. They had to call a female inspector to evict her, and that led to the spark of the entire apartheid revolution. She sat down so that America could stand up. That was the slogan which was used by them. She said, so what? Mahatma Gandhi, what an amazing person. We don't realize his value now. I feel very saddened by the fact that people say, oh, he's the guy who called partition, he's the guy who did so many things, and I don't know if people read history properly. But what a person, you know, a person who had the dream of becoming a doctor in his teens, but his parents told him no. In his 20s, he was a complete failure at public speaking. He was a terrible lawyer. He used to tell, I used to get up and I used to feel like sitting down. I used to feel giddy and vomiting because I used to feel so much fear. In his 30s, he was racially abused in South Africa, spitted upon, hit by the British. In his 40s and 50s, his own children left his house and told, you're a useless father. In his 60s and 70s, for 2,338 days, he spent in jail. But today when India looks at our freedom struggle, and if India has got freedom, it is only because this one man said, so what, if I have so many problems in life, I will still strive for freedom. You know, it was because of this man with unbelievable problems, unsurmountable problems throughout his life. He had problem after problem after problem. Isn't it? The world will always trouble you, but there was somebody who said, so what? The world will never leave you, isn't it? They crucified Jesus, who was the symbol of love. They assassinated Mahatma Gandhi, who was the symbol of non-violence. But these people said, so what? If we remember them, if we are living our life today, we are remembering these people, because these are the people who said, so what? They said, doesn't matter to all the problems which we have, we will still strive. We will still strive and try to get what we have to get. So never ever worry. That's the first cardinal principle you have to learn. Remember that you have to live your own life. You cannot live your life based on somebody else's dictum, isn't it? And in India especially true. Because every time somebody tells you something, your parents tell you something, your friends tell you something, you get so influenced by them, you decide that we have to live. I'll tell you the guaranteed way of leading an unhappy life is by making everybody else in your life happy. I'll tell you this by personal experience. When I was in 10th, my mother told, you have to get a rank, I'll be happy. I got a rank. She told, I'll be happy when you get into a good college. I got into an excellent college. Once I finished, I'll get happy when you get into a good job. I got a good job. I'll be happy when you get married. I got married. I'll be happy when you get a kid. I got a kid. Now, I'll be happy when your kid gets into a good school. The circle will keep on. See, and I'm not telling you to disobey your parents, please, for God's sake. 85% of the time, please obey your parents. If they tell you which shirt to wear, wear that shirt. If they tell you what food to eat, eat that food. If they tell you to come out for a dinner with them, go out with them. But when it is a matter of your own choice, where your life is going to change, if you don't like doing, if you want to do your MBA after your BBM or BCom or whatever, and they tell you get into the business, put your foot down, because those 5-10% of the decisions will make the difference in the rest of your. Obey them 85%, 90% of the time. If there is a choice where you are going to betray somebody as your friend you loved all your life, and they tell you get married to somebody else, tell no, because that will make a difference to your life, isn't it? So remember, 90% of the time, please obey your parents. I'm not telling you not, but where it matters most, put your head foot down and say, so what? It doesn't make a difference. Now let me tell you the second way in which I've overcome this fear. You know, there is one word in the English, in the entire Indian lexicon, which is common to all 26 official Indian languages, whether it's Tamil, Telugu, whether it is Assami, Oriya, Kashmiri, Sindhi, there is one single word which has the single, simple, or the same meaning across all 26 official Indian languages. You know what is that word? That word is not mata, pita, mummy, daddy. That we call by different names and different things. Isn't it? What is that one word? That one single word is vishwas of faith. Whether you take any language, vishwas is vishwas of faith. And that is one more way in which you can overcome this fear. When you start developing faith in your own ability, when you start getting the self-confidence, when you start getting the faith that I can do it irrespective of what, fear starts vanishing. How do you expect a person like me who can't see, a person who was a Hindi medium student till 3rd standard, 4th standard, to speak English in front of you? Because slowly I developed that faith. How I developed that faith, I'll tell you at a later point of time. But remember that if there is one way in which you can dispel fear from your life, it is by having faith or vishwas in your own ability. Develop that faith in your own self. You know, I'll just tell you two small incidents in history which have taken place. In fact, three small incidences in history which have taken place, which have changed the course of history just because people had faith. You know, in the February of 1953, there was a occasion where there were a few people who had congregated at the foothills of the Himalaya. Okay? And at the foothills of the Himalaya, there was a mourning ceremony. Why they congregated was because thousands of attempts had been made to conquer Mount Everest. And every single expedition had failed. There was one person from New Zealand who was Jack Peters, who was a very, very experienced mountaineer who had died in February trying to conquer the Mount Everest. To pay homage to him, there was another New Zealander, Edmund Hillary, who had come to the base of the Himalayas, and he was paying tribute to Jack Peters, who had tried to reach the Mount Everest but had died in his attempt. They asked Edmund Hillary to say a few words about those brave mountaineers who had tried to conquer Mount Everest but hadn't done it. Edmund Hillary came on stage and then he said something. He had tears in his eyes because his friend had died. But you know what he did? He pointed at the portrait of Mount Everest and he said, "See a Mount Everest, you can't grow a single inch, but you underestimate human potential. Our faith can grow much, much taller than you can grow. Because you will not grow, we will keep." And can you believe it? Just 3 months after that, Edmund Hillary, along with Sherpa Tenzing Norgay, conquered Mount Everest. Because his faith in himself had grown. He had challenged the mountain. The mountain can't grow a single inch. From the past 1,000 years, Mount Everest has remained 8,848 meters. It hasn't grown a single inch. But human faith, has it grown? Right from the time when we have gone to the moon, right from the time when we have come out with our mobile phones, right from the time when you have come out with the internet, every single phase of Indian and world history is marketed by people whose faith has grown and who have conquered the maximum of difficulties. Yes or no? We were not the same as we were in 1600, 1700. Human beings keep evolving. And one thing which has to evolve is the human faith. Once your faith evolves, there is no limit to what you can achieve. Let me tell you another incident. In 1954, it was considered impossible to run a mile. A mile is 1.6 kilometers under 4 minutes, under 240 seconds. Everybody who tried to run it before had said that we cannot run. In fact, medical science had proved, they had tried to prove it medically, that if you run a mile under 4 minutes, what's going to happen is your heart will burst open and you will die. They said that if you run a mile under 4 minutes, your heart will burst open, and nobody was able to do it. There was one doctor by name Roger Bannister. He decided, he said, "Whatever happens, I will try and break this barrier of 4 minutes. On May 29th, 1954, he took the plunge. He ran and ran and ran. In 3 minutes 59 seconds, he leapt over the finish line. He completed the mile within 4 minutes. And can you believe it? After Roger Bannister did it in May 29, 1954, by May 1956, 22 other athletes did the same feat. He did it in 1954. From the evolution of man till 1954, not one person did it. After 1954, in the next 2 years, 22 people did it. Was the barrier physical or was the barrier psychological? It was completely psychological. All because people feared. Isn't it? That psychological barrier is caused by fear. How could 22 people do it after that? It's impossible. They said it was impossible till 1954. Everybody used to get scared. But once you do it, once somebody shows the way, it becomes much easier to reach that goal. Have faith. I don't know if you all have heard of a person called Lance Armstrong. Anybody of you all have heard of this person? Who's Lance Armstrong? He's the world's greatest cyclist. Yes or no? He's won Tour de France, the World Cycling Championship, 7 times in a row. That's not great. The great thing is, he has won the World Cycling Championship, the Tour de France, 7 times, all after being diagnosed with testicular cancer. I don't need to tell you how painful it is to go through cancer. Going through testicular cancer is like going through hell, and that is sitting and driving a cycle with testicular cancer is even more painful because that part of your body is affected. You have such a great pain. And then too, you keep driving. You keep trying and winning the World Cycling Championship 7 times after getting cancer. It's unbelievable. It's just unbelievable. Just because he has faith. And I'll tell you why he has faith. Once a press reporter had asked him, Armstrong, don't you get scared of your cancer? And he answered brilliantly. He said, my biography cannot become my destiny. What is in my past cannot become my future. I have faith in my ability and I know that I'll win with or without cancer. I have faith in my ability and I know I'll win with or without my cancer. So he had faith. He had complete faith in his own ability. He had the way in which he could do certain things. He knew what he had to achieve and he had faith in his ability. And all World Cycling Championships 7 times. It all depends on your faith. Can you get that spark of faith in your heart? Where do you get that faith from? How do you cultivate faith, you'll ask me. Sir, I can say, so what? You can say, sir, get faith. How do I get that faith? Now let me tell you how I have developed faith over a period of time. Before that, let me tell you a small story and I'll link it to this. Because this is extremely important. For your next 3 years, if you want to achieve anything in life, it depends on what I'm going to tell you in the next 15-20 minutes. I went to a gym. I used to go to a gym around 4 or 5 years back. And I found something very strange. On one day, when I went to the gym, there was a huge rush. It was completely packed. I got very enamored. I told, my God, this guy who's running the gym has done some amazing PR work, he's done some amazing marketing activities, that's why it is so crowded. Where I used to wait for my bench press for something like 5 minutes, now it was taking me half an hour. I went and asked the owner of the gym, I told you I've done some amazing marketing activity. Suddenly there are 3 times more people than who come normally. What did you do? He told, sir, I didn't do anything, sir. And I told, how come there are so many people? He told, sir, you forgot to see the date, sir. I told, what is there in this date? He told, sir, today is January 2nd, sir, New Year, sir, everybody makes New Year resolution, sir. Don't worry, sir, by Jan 15, half the gym will be empty. And by Jan 15, as per his words, half the gym was empty. By February 1st, only I was gymming. Nobody else was there. If you go to Lal Bagh, you see the maximum rush for people going for walk, jogs is in January. You'll have full crowds over there. Complete cars, bikes, everybody makes a New Year resolution. But do they keep up to it? By February, March, you'll be only alone on that hill. That hill is there, no? You'll be alone, you'll be waiting for people to come. When the alarm bell rings at 6 o'clock in the morning or 6:30 in the morning, what do you do? The stupid function which they have introduced in the alarm clock, snooze. They'll put it on snooze, you sleep for another half an hour. When it rings again at 7 o'clock, you put it again on snooze and sleep for another. You tell yourself, I have to get up at 6 o'clock, 6:30 every day. But do you keep up to your commitment? No. And I'm telling you, the only key to achieving success or developing faith in your ability is keeping to your commitment. If I've achieved anything in life, if I've told you, I've achieved it only by keeping to my commitment. Once I joined Bishop Cotton Boys School after completing third standard in Hindi medium, I made a commitment to myself that I will learn two new words every day in English. Whatever happens, I kept learning those two words. And as you know, by 8th standard, I was picked up for the debate team. By 10th standard, I started winning every single debate which I took part in. Why? Because I kept to my commitment of learning two words every day. It's not that I became an overnight success. Even an overnight success takes 15 years. It was consistently, persistently, going on stage again and again. Irrespective of what fear I had, if I had nervousness, it's okay, I'll go on stage. I will take up the challenge and go every day. If I say I'm going to get up at 6 o'clock and keep that commitment to yourself. Otherwise, don't keep a commitment at all. Because every time you dishonor a commitment, there is something inside you which will tell, oh, stupid fellow, you can't even keep this commitment. What will you do in life? But once you keep a commitment, if I say I get up at 4:30 and I get up at 4:30, there is something inside you which will tell, Rajdeep, fantastic. You have got up today at 4:30, you can do much more in life. And slowly, when I start appreciating myself, when I start developing esteem for myself, my confidence grows. I conducted a quiz for Nokia 2 months back. Can you believe a blind person conducting a quiz? 6 teams on stage. I had to remember 45 questions, one after the other. Because if I don't have the luxury of seeing the screen. So I can't see what screen is going on. But I had faith in my ability. Because there's something inside me which tells me, Rajdeep, you can do it. You can get up at 4:30. You can do your pranayama every day. You can teach everything. Then why can't you conduct a quiz? Because I've grown in my commitment. I've grown in my self-confidence. Just by keeping my commitments. Once you decide on something, keep those commitments. Because every time you dishonor a commitment, it's like a scratch in the painting of your life. Every time you meet a commitment, it's like a stroke in the painting of your life. Do you want the life of yours to be filled with scratches? Or do you want your life to be filled with strokes? You want a beautiful painting? Or do you want a scratch-filled painting? You want a stroke-filled painting? Keep your commitments. Keep those small things. The greatest results in life are not achieved by sudden leaps. You achieve them by small, consistent, directed, self-motivated effort. Once you keep these small steps. When I joined teaching, I'll tell you this. I used to find that my voice was terrible. I could not capture the attention of students for more than 15-20 minutes. And that time I heard an interview by this guy called Jack Canfield. I don't know if you've heard of him. Jack Canfield is the author of a very, very famous series of books called Chicken Soup for the Soul. Jack Canfield and Mark Victor Hansen. And I was very amused as to how come a collection of stories made by different people can become such a big publishing phenomenon. He sold nearly 50 million copies. And the interviewer asked him just that. They asked him, Jack, how did you make Chicken Soup for the Soul such a great hit? And he said, I followed the rule of three. So they said, what is the rule of three? He said, the rule of three is very simple. In Native America, if you strike three times with your axe on the strongest, tallest tree, it will fall down within 3 months. Irrespective of the size of the tree, irrespective of the strength of the tree, it will definitely fall down. I said, why not I apply this to my book? I will do three things every day to make my book popular. I told I'll do one thing every day to make myself a good teacher. I started doing lessons on psychology. I started, I joined a voice modulation course where I could increase and decrease my voice in a proper, where I had 30% attendance in my class. By the end of 1 year, I started finding that people are finding places to sit in my class. It did not happen overnight. It was only because I kept to my commitment. Please, don't keep commitments for somebody else. Keep it for yourself. If you tell your friend, I'm going to meet him at 5 o'clock, don't go there at 6 o'clock. It's not for your friend. It's for you. Because you will grow in your self-esteem when you keep your commitments. And when you keep those commitments to yourself, your faith will start leaping. You will start growing in self-confidence. And when you start growing in self-confidence, there is no limit to what you can achieve. Keep your commitments day after day. If you are going to study, keep it. Keep to those commitments. And once you see that, you will see that your life will change miraculously. And what has happened in the past has happened. Please don't worry about your past. You might have been a failure, you might have been something. Every person, you need just a day to change your life. If you make up your mind today, what your past is all gone in the past, isn't it? I am a living example. I am a PhD in failures. I have done so many failures in my life, I don't even remember. But every time I failed, it's not that I have lost something, I have learned something out of it and I have gone further. Yes or no? So learn from your failures. It doesn't matter. You will make no mistakes. You are bound to make mistakes. Gandhiji made mistakes. Everybody makes mistakes. But the fool is one who does not learn from his mistakes. Learn from your mistakes. Your past is no guarantee. What was Mahatma Gandhi till they threw out that bag from his train? He was an ordinary barrister who could not speak. But that one incident changed his complete life. What was Mother Teresa? An ordinary school teacher? She had come for, she did not even have the courage to become the principal. She told, I'm going to live my entire life as a school teacher. But once she saw a person dying on the streets of Calcutta, something changed within her. She told, there are so many organizations to give honor to people who live. Is there any organization who give people honor when they die? And when she told a principal, I'm going to leave and I'm going to start an organization, they told, you're a fool, Sister Agnes, you're a fool. How will you do it? You don't have money. You don't have anything. She told, I have faith. And what is missionaries of charity today? 4 million people are fed every day by Mother Teresa's organization. Till 35 she was nothing. And after 35 she changed her complete life. Prophet Muhammad was nothing till he was 40. After 40 he started reciting the Quran. Every single person, you don't have to be a great person when you're born. Just make that decision today. And that decision can change your life. Let me end with a nice poem which I always end with. It's called The Guy in the Glass. Now listen to this poem carefully. You may win in your struggle for self, and the world may make you a king or queen for a day. But just look at the mirror and see what that person has to say. For it's not your teachers, friends, colleagues whose judgment on you must pass. The verdict that counts most in your life is the person looking back from the glass. So remember this, the verdict that counts most in your life is the person looking back from your. So if you make your decision today, I'm sure for the next 3 years, Garden City is going to get one of the most beautiful flowers which they've ever produced. And Garden City, the name itself is like that.